My name is Scott Benzie. I'm the Director of Marketing at Dundas Data Visualization. I'm not going to give you too much of a background on us because I know Nelson is going to get into it here. Long story short, one of the things we're very passionate about is data visualization. While we are software-based and at the core of our business is a piece of software, everything we do is with the best intentions towards representing data factually. That's one of the things Nelson's going to talk to you about today. It is very important to us. You know, numbers and figures can lie, data can lie, and graphically representing that information properly is really at the core of what we do at Dundas. I'm not sure what everybody's core competencies are in the room today, but we are always hiring. So if anybody is looking for internships or jobs, our head of development has told me that if there are any software developers in the room, to come talk to me after the presentation, please. We have a bunch of exciting things coming up. So if any of you are interested in getting into the data visualization field, please don't hesitate to come talk to me. Again, my name is Scott, and I will be here after Nelson presents. That being said, I'd like to present Nelson Ng to you. He is our principal consultant and our guru of everything good about data visualization. So thank you for your time. I'd like to thank the Association of Information Systems here at U of T for bringing us in, and hopefully we can do this again, and hopefully we'll generate some good conversation. All yours, Nelson.
Thanks, Scott. You guys hear me at the back? Everybody okay? First of all, I wanted to thank, again, Association for Information Systems here at U of T, and in particular, David, Kim, and Octavio. I don't know, can't see anything. Thank you, guys. You guys have been awesome. And thank you all for joining this evening. Hopefully you've got a bit of caffeine in your system. I'll try my best not to be boring. There are more people than I thought there would be in this room. I'd like to keep this open all the same, so if you have any questions, just maybe raise your hand. John over there is our mic rover, and we'll maybe get a mic over to you. I'm particularly excited to be presenting some concepts about data visualization to you today. So without further ado, let me just launch into this presentation. You've probably, no doubt, heard a lot about data lately. We're more than half a century now into the information age. Concepts and marketing buzzwords like big data, data scientists, and the internet of everything are all over the place. I think we're at a point where if we just try to describe how much data is collected, stored, and organized every single year, the number of bytes, orders of magnitude, and trailing zeros are almost impossible to imagine. Even the words we use to quantify how much data we have are starting to get more and more ridiculous. We have gigabytes, terabytes, petabytes, exabytes, and now zettabytes. The engineering challenges that we must overcome to handle all of this data are incredible. Data is being collected everywhere. We have sensors in just about everything. It's in our shoes now, in our plants. Big data and analytics help us do everything from hailing a cab to analyzing even your voice when you've been on hold for an hour to see how irate you are. So for all this hype and all this excitement, you'd think that the data challenges of yesteryear are gone. Well, this isn't what we've seen at Dundas. In fact, if you listen in on the calls that we have all the time with prospects and clients, you'll probably be surprised at how basic some of the data challenges they have are. We still hear things like drowning in data, analysis paralysis, many versions of the truth, information silos, and people exclaiming, I spend all of my time putting reports together rather than analyzing the data or doing anything with it. What we've learned is that while we've come a long way with regards to collecting, storing, and organizing all this data, all of it is only worth something if this data is understood by human beings. And today, for most of us, consuming this insane volume of data is sort of like drinking out of a fire hose. And even that might be an understatement. A lot of people we talk to feel trapped, hence the term analysis paralysis. They don't know what to do with all this data, but they know that it's worth looking at somehow. To me, this is tragic. I have to wonder how much we actually know about the world around us. Even beyond the business world, if you look at hot button topics in the news, where your tax money goes, what unemployment actually looks like, what our violent crime statistics are, how we're managing the cost of healthcare. We debate, argue, take extreme positions, and sometimes we even fight over things that we're not entirely sure of. Now, the term last mile, is used in telecommunications, supply chain management, and transportation. It describes the very last leg of a journey. Ignore it, and all the investments you make beforehand are for naught. Now, the last mile of the information journey is the human brain. And we tend to think that compared to computers, humans are vastly inferior at processing data. And certainly, at least when it comes to recalling facts and figures, this is quite true. Dean Buonomano, professor of neurobiology and psychology at the University of California, wrote in his book, Brain Bugs, "The fact of the matter is that your brain was simply not built to store unrelated bits of information, such as names and numbers. Fortunately, for all of its inherent weaknesses, the brain does indeed have a few tricks up its sleeve. Consider the amount of technology and computing power that's required to develop a computer that can defeat a human opponent at chess or Jeopardy, like Watson. And for all of this power, consider that computers are still confounded when it comes to reading distorted words and letters. If you've ever encountered a system like CAPTCHA, it can be infuriating sometimes because even I can't read it. And this same technology is actually being used in quite an extraordinary fashion by millions of people every day now to help digitize books, newspapers, and old-time radio shows, and that's been called reCAPTCHA. Pretty cool stuff. Clearly, there's something to the way our brains work that gives us an incredible edge. 70% of our body's sense receptors are in our eyes. That's incredible. 50% of our brain is devoted to the visual sense. It's no accident that when we say, "Oh, now I see it," that's synonymous with understanding. There's an immensely strong link between seeing something and cognition. It's quite easy to see how incredibly effective our eyes are at processing data. Here are four kind of seemingly random sets of numbers. How many of you will take a moment now to study and see if you can find anything? Good luck. How many people have a stats background here? Come on. Okay, now let's try it. This is the same data visualized using very simple dot plots. The information you get from this is almost instantaneous. You don't have to know what the numbers are or what we're even measuring here. You can see that the human brain is extraordinarily powerful at processing this sort of information. Let's put a real-life example on the screen. So, anybody who works in business is going to deal with a much more complicated version of this. We're looking at sales revenue for the year. Can you guys in the back kind of see the numbers? So, we've got U.S. and European sales, really high-level stuff, January right through to December. And study that for a moment to see if you see any patterns, any outliers, any exceptions. Here's that same data visualized in the most basic line chart. So what kind of patterns, if we can get some audience participation, what kind of patterns do you guys see here? You're not allowed to answer. I'm sorry. Anybody? Yeah.
Well, the most obvious is U.S. is trending up, but it cycles every couple of months. Europe is flatlining and dips in August for some reason.
And how long did that take you to process?
A few moments.
Yeah. And so you've recognized exactly what there is. We've got a generally increasing trend in the U.S. seems to cycle every 3 months. We've got this dip every quarter. Might be an indication that salespeople tend to work harder at the end of each quarter. And Europe is largely flat. We've got an anomaly in August. We don't know what that is. Could be bad data. Maybe they're on vacation. Now, why does this work so well? Here's how our visual sense works. This is as described by an author called Stephen Few. Light bounces off of surfaces and is sensed by our eyes. Now, any object that we perceive as a whole is actually broken down into a whole bunch of little visual attributes. And these properties are known as pre-attentive attributes. Pre-attentive means that they happen without and even before cognition. Your brain's just naturally tuned to sense these. We'll go over these in greater detail in a bit. But what happens when we're presented with a data graphic like the one we just saw is that we perceive it and we think about it at the same time. This is called parallel processing, and it's enormously powerful. When you think about how much data has just been presented in front of you, and you, without really having to think about it, you already have a pretty good idea of what's going on. We'll revisit these pre-attentive attributes later on. Colin Ware, researcher, a well-known kind of visual perception researcher, has said this. Sorry to read this. The human visual system is a pattern seeker of enormous power and subtlety. The eye and the visual cortex of the brain form a massively parallel processor that provides the highest bandwidth channel into human cognitive centers. Hardly sounds like we're talking about humans here. However, the visual system has its own rules. We can easily see patterns presented in certain ways, but if they are presented in other ways, they become invisible. If we can understand how perception works, our knowledge can be translated into rules for displaying information. If we disobey these rules, our data will be incomprehensible or misleading. So let's get an example of how that works. Another challenge, just blurt it out if you can figure this out. I just want you to count the number sevens here.
Seven?
Wow, okay, not bad. Okay, this wasn't as powerful a demonstration as I thought it would be. I was hoping for some more outlandish numbers. I've heard 29 before, so. But I don't have to go on and on about, just here, all we've done is tweak the colors. And we've instantly revealed a lot of information. Hans Rosling, how many of you have heard of him before? Okay, so bear with me, this might not be new for you. He may be known for having the world's most famous bubble chart. He's known as a rock star of statistics. He's a professor, a statistician, and founder of an organization called Gapminder, and he's an advocate for global health. So I'm about to show you a quick video here.
On my own work too, I teach global health. And I know having the data is not enough. I have to show it in ways people both enjoy and understand. Now, I'm going to try something I've never done before, animating the data in real space with a bit of technical assistance from the crew.
So, here we go. First, an axis for health. Life expectancy, from 25 years to 75 years. And down here, an axis for wealth, income per person. $400,000, $4,000, and $40,000. So down here is poor and sick, and up here is rich and healthy. Now, I'm going to show you the world 200 years ago, in 1810. Here come all the countries. Europe brown, Asia red, Middle East green, Africa south of Sahara blue, and the Americas yellow. And the size of the country bubble showed the size of the population. And in 1810, it was pretty crowded down there, wasn't it? All countries were sick and poor. Life expectancy were below 40 in all countries. And only the UK and the Netherlands were slightly better off, but not much. And now, why start the world? The Industrial Revolution makes countries in Europe and elsewhere move away from the rest. But the colonized countries in Asia and Africa, they are stuck down there. And eventually, the Western countries get healthier and healthier. And now, we slow down to show the impact of the First World War and the Spanish flu epidemic. What a catastrophe! And now I speed up through the 1920s and the 1930s. And in spite of the Great Depression, Western countries forge on towards greater wealth and health. Japan and some others try to follow, but most countries stay down here. Now, after the tragedies of the Second World War, we stop a bit to look at the world in 1948. 1948 was a great year. The war was over, Sweden topped the medal table at the Winter Olympics, and I was born. But the differences between the countries of the world was wider than ever. United States was in the front, Japan was catching up. Brazil was way behind, Iran was getting a little richer from oil, but still had short lives. And the Asian giants, China, India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, and Indonesia, they were still poor and sick down here. But look what is about to happen. Here we go again. In my lifetime, former colonies gained independence, and then finally they started to get healthier and healthier and healthier. And in the 1970s, then countries in Asia and Latin America started to catch up with the Western countries. They became the emerging economies. Some in Africa follows. Some Africans were stuck in civil war and others hit by HIV. And now we can see the world today in the most up-to-date statistics. Most people today live in the middle, but there are huge differences at the same time between the best of countries and the worst of countries. And there are also huge inequalities within countries. These bubbles show country averages, but I can split them. Take China, I can split it into provinces. There goes Shanghai. It has the same wealth and health as Italy today. And there is the poor inland province Guizhou. It is like Pakistan. And if I split it further, the rural parts are like Ghana in Africa. And yet, despite the enormous disparities today, we have seen 200 years of remarkable progress. That huge historical gap between the West and the rest is now closing. We have become an entirely new converging world. And I see a clear trend into the future. With aid, trade, green technology and peace, it's fully possible that everyone can make it to the healthy, wealthy corner. Well, what you just seen in the last few minutes is a story of 200 countries shown over 200 years and beyond. It involved plotting of 120,000 numbers. Pretty neat, huh?
So that's from a BBC series, Joy of Stats. What'd you guys think? It's pretty cool. That was one of the, when I started working at Dundas in 2009, that was one of the first videos I saw. And it's always stuck with me since. I mean, can you imagine processing 120,000 numbers and trying to make sense of it all without visualization? Data graphics, we can no longer see them merely as fantasy or optional alternatives to tables and numbers. They have the unique ability to solve problems that tables and numbers cannot. They take the process of understanding data beyond the silos of highly specialized people and people with majors in statistics, and they democratize that information to people of average technical ability. And that's why I'm here today. I'm here today to show you how you can easily improve the way that you analyze and present data in your daily lives by using some very simple techniques and principles. The practice of data visualization, when you apply it properly, has enormously positive implications on how we make decisions, whether as members of an organization, as individuals, or as an informed citizenry. How many of you think data visualization is pretty cool? So I don't have to sell you on that, and that's why I decided to call this presentation Beyond the Hype. I think we don't have to convince people that it's pretty cool. I think we have to move on to the next step and help people understand how we can derive more value. When we spend time creating it for businesses, well, where's the return on our investment? And how can we realize that? I think data visualizations today are kind of where PowerPoint was at when it first came out. How many of you remember PowerPoint slides from the 90s? I remember my first time creating a PowerPoint deck. I hit every button I could, animations, word art, typewriter sounds, explosions. It was about PowerPoint. It wasn't about communicating. And then we have web design, about a decade ago. People started going nuts with all sorts of different types of graphics and different ways of designing web pages. They made it as cool as possible. And now when we look back at what our Angel Fire or GeoCities sites used to look like, it's kind of appalling. And I think that with regards to the data visualization explosion and the infographic explosion, chances are that when we look back at what we're doing today, we might see some of the same things. I work as a consultant, at a company called Dundas Data Visualization. We're based in Toronto. And we have a mission that's very, very simple. And that is to help people make better and faster decisions with their data. We do that by helping people visualize their data, and often we just visualize it for them. Often the first thing we have to do is actually diffuse the hype. People are expecting animations and 3D and explosions. The goal of a visualization is not to be cool or to even be beautiful. The goal of a visualization is to solve a business problem as effectively and as efficiently as possible. Being cool or beautiful, these things are byproducts of great design, and we'll talk about what that means. So what do we do at Dundas? We sell software and services. Our software is a development tool known by developers as a platform that helps people create custom dashboards. It allows people of average technical ability to create dashboards that are hooked up to their company's data sources, and also allows developers of extraordinary technical ability to go crazy and do all sorts of custom things. Our services team offers consulting, advisory, training, and end-to-end implementation. We do everything for organizations. We've been around for about 20 years, and we started off really as a software shop. We created tools for software developers to create their own graphics and put them into programs or websites. These evolved into data visualization tools, and they became extraordinarily successful. Three of our products, Dundas Chart, Gauge, and Map, were actually acquired by Microsoft in 2007, and if you use SQL Server reporting services, SharePoint, Visual Studio, a lot of those, the visual components, come from us. In 2009, though, we took all that power that was formerly in the domain of developers, and we started making that available to average business users. People use Excel or maybe even Access, PowerPoint. How can we help these people extract the same amount of power that was previously only available to extraordinarily technical people? And so our product that we launched in 2009 is called Dundas Dashboard, and we'll show you a little bit about that today. Hands up if you're from Dundas, to let people know. So we've got a bunch of folks here from Dundas that are here afterwards. We've got drinks, snacks, pizza, I think, David. So if you want to stick around, we'd be happy to talk to you. That's why we're here. If you want to learn more about things, I don't want to take up too much time in this setting, we'd love for you to come chat with us, and we'd love to learn more about you as well. We've got over 70 people today. And we're in the Don Mills and Eglinton area. If you're not familiar, it's about 15 minutes north of here. And we're in that building on the right. And so beyond attending this workshop, we'd love to have the chance to meet you all. Now, we tend to think that visualization is a bit of a recent phenomenon. But the truth is that visual communication has existed for thousands of years. 5,000 years ago, some of the first geographic maps started appearing on clay tablets and on the walls of caves. This map is called the Yu Chi Tu map, map of the tracks of Yu the Great. This was created by an unknown geographer around the 11th century. 12th century in China. And it's an extraordinary piece of work because it's remarkably precise. And this is one of the landmarks when you look back at the history of data visualization. Often it will start here. It was hundreds of years ahead of its time. In 1701, English astronomer Edmund Halley created this map, and it was the first map to show lines of equal magnetic variation. Quite an incredible accomplishment. Whoops, sorry about that, zooming out over and over again. In 1854, a London physician by the name of John Snow created one of the best known thematic maps of its time. How many of you have seen this before? Okay, I'm not teaching anybody anything new here. I'm going to plow along. His analysis, well, what was happening during the time is there was an outbreak of cholera. And what he did was he took the most accurate map of London he could, and he started plotting out all the instances of deaths from cholera on a map. And what he realized was that a lot of them were occurring around the Broad Street pump, right in the middle. And at his request, they removed the handle from the pump, and the cases of cholera disappeared almost instantly. So a very early application of plotting data on a map. Now, it wasn't until 17th century, though, that Descartes started plotting data on a two-dimensional axis. So he started, he abstracted data from the physical world and started plotting it in 2D. And this took us to 1786. William Playfair, Scottish social scientist, created this chart to show trade deficits and surpluses. His inventions include the pie chart and the bar chart. And he was one of the first to use lines to show changes throughout time, quite like you see here. How many of you have seen this one? Wow, okay. I'll be brief then, just so we don't let down the people who haven't seen this before. Joseph Menard was a French engineer. 1869, he created this graphic, and it shows you the fate of Napoleon's army. So it starts at the Niemen River, and if you see that brown band, that shows the size of Napoleon's army. It starts off at 422,000 strong. And the thickness of the band as it goes across the map shows the size of the army as they travel to Russia. And the black band shows the retreat from Russia. And what's particularly striking is you can see all the different changes to the size of the army, all the casualties at each point. What's even more incredible about this chart is if you follow the retreat at various points here, he's also linked it to the temperature that the soldiers were experiencing at the time. It actually shows the really bitterly cold winter temperatures that might have contributed to a lot of the deaths. It's a pretty gory scene, actually. It's a data graphic, but it's incredibly multidimensional. Think about just the sheer amount of data here that's presented to you at a single glance. Often considered as one of the best statistical graphics of all time. Very cool. Moving on to Florence Nightingale. She was an English statistician, founder of modern nursing, and she invented the polar area diagram. But this takes us to the 19th and 20th century. We have Charles Babbage, who created the difference engine, Alan Turing, father of maybe modern computer science. IBM in the 50s began the data management industry. In the 70s, we get to the first appearance of data graphics on a computer screen, appearance of personal computers, and one of the first computers that I started working on when I was a kid, and that's the Macintosh, graphical interfaces. And shortly after this, Microsoft Excel. And in the history of data graphics, this is a pretty noteworthy development because it allowed all of us to start tinkering around with software and creating our own data graphics very quickly. In the meantime, three more notable figures in data visualization. Jacques Bertin, he was one of the first to recognize that if you present something in accordance to how your brain works, that could be quite extraordinary. John Tukey, famous statistician, in 1977 came out with this landmark book, Exploratory Data Analysis, and it was a huge paradigm shift for statistics because it introduced the concept of using visualizations for statistical analysis. 1983, Edward Tufte came out with this book, The Visual Display of Quantitative Information, known to many as the Bible of Modern Information Graphics. Tufte was, or is, sorry, professors came out with quite a few books since, and he introduced the notion of things like the data to ink ratio, the spark line. We'll talk about a couple of those things later. But what he, the main thing that he did in my mind was highlight how bad a lot of data graphics are and what precisely was wrong with them. Fast forward to 2004, Stephen Few, known as a thought leader for data graphics for use in business, came out with this book, Show Me the Numbers. We've got a bunch over there, and you'll see what they're there for in a bit. He came out with three books, one which was devoted to dashboard design. And that is really one of the most important books for dashboard design out there today. And you'll see some of his principles at work as well. Where does that bring us to today? Information graphics are everywhere. They're exploding. We can hardly count just how many are appearing in the world today. Every major news organization, bloggers, are all using this. This is a really good visualization, actually, of the 2008 US election done by the New York Times. I don't know if you've heard of David McCandless TED Talks, but he created this graphic. It's actually quite controversial in best practices circles, but what he did was show how, without a sense of data, how skewed our news is sometimes. We make a huge fuss about things that aren't actually all that important. Mountains out of molehills, for example. SimCity 2013 just came out, and here's another example of data graphics now permeating in, even into our video games. So, they're not all good. And what I wanted to do is spend a little bit of time to show you what we're doing wrong. And this is not to be mean-spirited, but I think the best way to learn is sometimes to see what not to do. So bear with me as we venture through this hall of shame. This one's a doozy. These are called cone charts, and they're plotted on a three-dimensional axis. Any comments about this one, actually? How many of you think it's a good graphic? Yeah.
Is it serious?
This one actually isn't serious. That's a good call. This one was made in jest. Somebody basically went in Excel and turned on every single feature he could, flipped it on, and fine. Here's a serious one. Any comments? Now, you guys are all laughing. What is wrong with it, though? Let's actually try and dissect this.
It's hiding a lot of the information needlessly.
Yeah, we're obscuring a lot of the data, and that's one of the bigger problems with 3D graphics. Anything else? Yeah?
It's not three-dimensional information, it's just n-dimensional.
Yeah, that's another good point. There's some hands at the back there.
So it's not proportional to like the height of the phone is a little off in the basis. I think this is a 3D effect.
Yeah. On that note, if we didn't have the numbers there, how effectively would you be able to read that? Okay, let's move on. I'm not harping on 3D, but I'm doing this to kind of prove a point. What is the value of hammer in March? Go. Anybody?
98.
I think it's a little bit over 100, can't be certain. What about the wrench market in March? Is that higher or lower than the hammer market? And it's easy to laugh, but when you turn on a lot of these programs, the first thing they'll do is pivot it on an axis, because that's inevitably what a lot of bosses want you to do to spice up your presentations in PowerPoint. Any comments about this one? We all use pie charts. I used two earlier. What do you think about this one?
Mixing categories.
Anything else?
Too many choices.
Too many choices?
Too many options. Like, you're comparing a blue to, where's that other blue kind of deal? Like,
yeah.
Like the purple or the green. Where's the green? Oh, there it is.
How many of you?
It's not fast to get the concepts.
Absolutely. You're doing a lot of trips left and right with your eyes. I saw another head back there. Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. There's varying numbers out there. I've heard 5 or 6 might be acceptable, but 3 or 4 might be a good rule. When I used it, I just used it to show 2 numbers. But this is actually pretty, we're talking about data density and consuming all this information in the world. This is actually pretty data light as well. There are 9 data points in total here. Yeah. Yeah, for sure. How many of you have red-green color deficiency? That could be a problem as well. So we don't have 9 different slices on a pie chart here. This is a real graphic we found online. Any comments about this one? Yeah. Yeah, they might have been able to choose a different scale for the y-axis. I think that's not an unreasonable statement.
amongst other things.
Right? I think this might have just been sloppy on the part of whoever put it together. What is the y-axis, actually? What is it showing us? Is it showing us anything, or is it just kind of placed there randomly? This one was not done in jest. I actually did find this one. So a lot of curious things going on today. What about this, though? Kind of the Teletubbies color scheme.
I don't know what I'm looking at. There's no title. There's.
There's an omission of data. That could be my fault because I kind of just plucked these images online. But about the data graphic itself, yes?
Like for the blue columns, I can't even see how high they are.
Yeah, we're using a lot of, it's not too different from the background, is it? And really, are the colors necessary?
Yeah. They're also lying in the y-axis. Zooming in.
I'm going to get to that. No, I'm joking. You're absolutely right. It starts at 20,000, and that is known as the lie factor. This one has quite a bit of a lie factor. We'll talk about that in a little bit. We've already talked about pie charts. The only thing I wanted to highlight here were this extraordinary use of gradients in everything that we see today because they're so cool. Really, is it necessary? And forget this. Let's take a look at something that actually doesn't look unreasonable. How many of you can spot the big problem here? You're not allowed, John. Sorry. Yeah.
2010 and 2012 are problematic. Well, I mean, they're all problematic, but 2012 is lower. It should be higher.
They fixed the sense, by the way. If you go back to this one, it's done properly now. And again, to your point, the y-axis is lying. And also, not an incredible amount of information here. That's a lot of space used up for 4 numbers, really. Yeah, it's not just isolated to one news organization. I don't think if you're still fetching for the answer, the slices don't quite add up to it. So that's our little journey through the Hall of Shame. And we can laugh about it here, but how many of you have seen similar atrocities, if not quite so bad, in your daily work or even at school? And so, really, when I learned about data visualization, when I started studying, a lot of the principles weren't obvious to me, but now when you kind of know what they are, even without knowing what the principles are, it's kind of hard not to miss them. So what are these principles? There are many. There's so many books on this. I don't have a lot of time today. I could probably go on until tomorrow morning. if I had the time and your energy. But I've chosen five to hopefully leave with you today. So principles of data presentation. Choose the most appropriate tool for the job. Show the data and do not distort it, kind of do no evil, do no harm. Show context, relationships, explanation, causality. To clarify, add more detail. And five, good design is as little design as possible. I took that from Data Ramsey's an industrial designer, and that was one of his principles that really struck a chord with me. So let's talk about the first one, choosing the most appropriate tool for a job. When should we use data or a data graphic or a visualization? Should we always strive to use one? If our numbers look boring, should we turn it into a pie chart? I tend to think that we shouldn't. Tables are useful for a few reasons. They're useful when you need to look up individual values. You need to know precisely what that number is. When you need to compare values, when you need precision. Hard to get a lot of precision on a bar chart, for example, particularly when there's a really large y-axis range. When you need to look at multiple units of measure, hard to do that on any sort of a graphic. And when you want to show details and their sums, this is generally what a table is good for. So let's talk about a graph. Graphs are useful because they show trends, patterns, outliers, and an incredible amount of data all at once. So here, this was a sample done for a consumer packaged goods company. And they're measuring brand awareness across all the different sales channels that they sell in. And immediately you can see grocery dominates, drug, maybe some sort of promotion, you know, in various drug stores has started in September, and we've seen a huge uptick there. You think a good visualization forces you to think about the content rather than the visualization itself. We're not talking about how this pie chart was, or this line chart was put together. But instead, we're trying to figure out what's going on, what is it trying to tell us. And that's the hallmark of a good visualization. So, we talked earlier about pre-attentive attributes. I'm going to zoom out of this just a little bit. And these were defined by Colin Ware, a researcher we talked about earlier. And there are quite a few. I'm not going to go into all of them today. Certainly, if you want some of these sources later on, feel free to find me afterwards, and I'd be happy to share them with you. But these are the pre-attentive attributes that our brain naturally senses. Our visual system naturally is able to perceive these without even thinking about it, ahead or even without cognition. Of the ones you see here, which ones do you think are good for presenting quantitative values? Is that question clear? So which one of these attributes would you use to show numbers? Or differences in numbers?
Two D position.
Yeah, definitely. A very powerful way of showing quantitative values. Anybody else?
Probably length or size.
Length and size.
And or, yeah.
Yeah. Length, we use that in bar charts all the time. Size does show a difference. You can see that the big dot is a lot bigger than the small dots. What the human brain isn't so good at seeing, though, is how much bigger or what that value is in relation to the smaller dots. And so if we are to take a look, the green ones here, the ones that I've highlighted in green, show attributes that are particularly effective when it comes to encoding quantitative data. And the yellow ones do the job, but not nearly as precisely. They're not as effective. Size, it's hard to determine. The human brain's not that good at discerning area. Width, how much thicker is that thick line versus the thin ones? Intensity, we can see that different dots might be darker than some others, but it's hard to judge by how much. This makes the process of presenting quantitative data quite simple, actually. It reduces the number of choices we have in the vast majority of cases that we see today, and we do this for a living, we design dashboards for a living. If you want to break down the most effective things, they can be broken down into four categories. We have points, which utilize 2D position. Bars, which is length. Boxes, which is a combination of 2D position and length. I'm not going to talk too much about these today, but the boxes you see here are known as box whisker plots. Really good for showing distributions. And lines, of course, for showing trend. And depending on the type of problem you want to solve, you pick the appropriate tool for the job. For example, what are bar charts very effective at doing?
Direct comparison.
Yeah, they're the best for making comparisons between values or between bars, showing differences in magnitude, etc. They can also be used for showing a trend, but the line chart shows that a bit more saliently, doesn't it? So, in terms of choosing the appropriate tool for the job, really, you can narrow your choices for the vast majority of business questions, in our opinion anyway, down to these four. Point charts, scatter plots, very effective, especially if you're showing two different quantitative axes. Bars for showing comparisons, trends, change. Boxes for showing distributions, and lines, of course, for showing trends or patterns. For doing time analysis, or analysis along a scale that's in order. Two, show the data, and please do not distort it. If you aren't sure what to do, at the very least, try not to distort it. This came up earlier, but how many of you can guess what the value of this class is? I provided the value of my other classes, just by judging the length of the bar. Any guesses? 62, that was remarkably precise. Now I've put in the y-axis, and how close were you? And so what is the value of a bar chart when you actually need to put the numbers on it to help people know what it means? The only useful part of a bar chart is the length of the bar. And when you misrepresent the y-axis, and we see this a lot, and it's even a default on a lot of different software offerings out there, you're essentially lying. As a gentleman mentioned earlier, about the data. And this is a form of data distortion, or what we know as the lie factor. If we were to change the y-axis to zero, this is what that bar chart actually looks like. It doesn't exaggerate the differences. But there are times where you actually want to highlight the differences in the value, especially if they're all really close together. It's kind of hard to see what the differences are sometimes. So what's the solution there? Any ideas? If I don't want the y-axis to start at zero, and I want the differences between these values to be a little bit more visually profound. Any ideas to how we could design this a bit differently?
Start y at
60. But then we introduce the lie factor again, don't we?
Okay.
So without lying.
Well, you can keep the same scale, but start at 60. Like essentially the space between 60 and 80, for example, would just start it at 60. It would just be a very narrow graph.
Yeah.
I tried to defend the young lady there a little bit.
Yeah. Well, it's the most obvious option. One thing I don't really see people doing is just, this is not the way to do it, by the way. How many of you see a problem with this? Yeah, or actually, sorry, what is the problem with this? Yeah.
The line, like the points are connected.
Yeah.
They aren't. It's not a trend, it's just facts that are unrelated.
Yeah, these are categories that have nothing to do with each other, and we're linking them together as if it were a trend. In the absence of that, and you can also do this pivoted the other way, show it horizontally, is just to show a dot. And this takes out the lie factor, We can start the scale at something even more ridiculous, like 68. It's not always the right thing to do. It really depends. You have to use a little bit of judgment here as to, are you exaggerating something, or is there a possibility by doing this that you're misleading a person? These differences, which look really large, aren't actually that big at all. Show the data and do not distort it. How many of you, any guesses as to what the value of the fourth quarter is?
12.
Not bad. Sorry? 50. Yeah, not bad. What is the, in terms of pre-attentive attributes, what does a pie chart use here? If you remember some of the pre-attentive attributes. We're judging area, aren't we? And what's wrong with the area that we're showing here? Well, yeah?
Actually, I had a question about the pre-attentive attributes.
Yes.
So I studied cognitive psychology in undergrad, and to my understanding, it was more about, has nothing to, it's precognitive, right? So
yes.
It's not something we can be attentive to. So I'm not sure, I don't know, I guess I'm just challenging how you're using that word here, because I'm not sure it's the appropriate.
I'm not a cognitive scientist, so for me, I am just studying it. What it means to me is that our human sense isn't naturally tuned to discerning differences in values with some, and that if we break some of the rules, we could mislead people or distort the data. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm not sure that's what the term means in psychology, though, but.
Okay.
Yeah.
You can correct me later,
okay.
If anything. I'm open to being wrong.
Okay.
But what we're doing here is, by pivoting this pie chart and putting it in three dimensions, we're actually exaggerating the slice of the first quarter here. And so this is what it actually looks like without that perspective. But it's still kind of hard to get a sense of what the fourth quarter value, isn't it? Well, what if you weren't to use a pie and you were simply to use a bar chart? Simple as that. So, moving on. Show context, relationships, and causality. This is actually a sample that we've built on a dashboard. This is a piece of it. And here we're trying to show different agents who work at a call center. And FCR means first call resolution, meaning on the first call, how many of these agents are actually resolving the problem that's been presented to them by the caller? And we could actually improve this a little bit by showing you, this is a variation on something called a bullet graph, to show, to use bars and length of a line to show differences in value. But what if an agent's simply having a bad week? Let's pick on somebody here. Let's take a look at Heidi. Her first call resolution percentage this week is 73. 73% of the calls that she takes are resolved the first time around. And what if she's just having a bad week? What if she normally does really good? So how can we enhance this data graphic to show maybe a trend over time? So what's the first thing most of us would do? What's the first type of chart you would use to show different trends? Line chart? So here's what a lot of us would do right off the bat. And we introduce a few problems here, obviously. Quite like the pie chart with many slices, we have to make a lot of different trips left and right to figure out what the colors mean. It's almost impossible to see what's going on here. It's a mess of lines. Edward Tufte, we mentioned earlier, quite a while ago actually, invented this concept called a spark line. And it's very simple. It's just a line chart, collapsed axes, and it shows you just the shape of the line. It's not a precise tool. It just gives you an idea of what's going on. So if we go back to Heidi, we can see that 73 is actually one of her better weeks. And so it's, we actually know somebody called Heidi. Sorry, Heidi. What we've done here is by introducing more data, we've shown a little bit more context. We're trying to paint a better picture of what's going on at this call center. And we can also introduce a little bit more. AHT, sorry about all these acronyms, they're quite commonly known in the call center world, is average handling time. How long does it take, on average, for you to handle a call? And this is measured in minutes. And we can see Heidi right now is averaging at 26. But that's today. All it takes is a couple of calls with some really complicated cases, and that could really change the average. How useful is this average, actually? What we've done here is actually show all the different calls that are being made in a table format. And so the y-axis, which is presented horizontally here, shows you, represents minutes, and the squares represent calls, and the triangles represent chats. And what you can see here, instead of seeing just a bunch of averages, because they're maybe not all that useful, is to see where some of the outliers are, things that are far off to the left or to the right. And because dashboards and a lot of visual software are interactive these days, all you have to do is just click on it to figure out which call that was and get some more transactional level detail on it. So very quickly, by adding more data, as counterintuitive as that sounds, we add context, we show causality, show a little bit of mechanism, and we try and explain things as clearly as we can. And that's really the goal of a data graphic at the end of the day. And this goes to our next principle, which is to clarify, add detail. As counterintuitive as that sounds, Edward Tufte's quote here is that when it comes to presenting data and information, and most unconventional design strategies revealed, to clarify, add detail, just like we did there. Last principle, if you guys are still with me there. Good design is as little design as possible. And to demonstrate what this means, I'm now going to talk about dashboards. I haven't really talked about them. That's our core business at Dundas. We're going to explain what that is and why having as little design as possible matters. So, three ways we consume data today. There are many different ways of slicing it. These are just three that I've chosen. We have reports, we have ad hoc analysis, and we have dashboards. I'm going to explain what they are. Reports, you probably know what they are. Anything presented, typically in tabular form. It's very free form if you use Excel, Access, Crystal Reports, any sort of reporting software out there. That's all you're doing is you're creating a report. They can span many pages, they could be on one. They're not particularly purpose-built. The reason I'm describing that is because reports are multi-purpose, dashboards are not. So that's the first distinction. Ad hoc analysis tools. This is a snapshot from our software, and it's basically, I don't know if you've seen anything like this before, but it gives you a canvas in the middle that you can just drag and drop different metrics onto to see the shape of the data. Ad hoc analysis tools really are, today anywhere, are primarily used by technical people with background in quantitative analysis, data scientists, data analysts. But they exist because you might not know what you're looking for sometimes. And so this allows you to explore and discover new things. So that brings us to dashboards. What is a dashboard? There are many definitions that I hear when I talk to people. People will say, well, it's a graphical way of showing numbers about your business. We'd like to be a little bit more precise than that. To us, a dashboard shows you only the most important information, so not everything, only that which is critical. And it needs to be critical in order to achieve business objectives. So it's not just important, it's important to you specifically when it comes to achieving the mandates that you have in your jobs. And this information is presented to you at a glance. So it's not over many pages, certainly not over hundreds of pages. I've dealt with reports that have been quite thick in the past. This is meant to be at a glance. And that's an important distinction as well. How many of you use dashboards today at work? Okay. So not very many of you. Why? How many of you actually have access to dashboards? Maybe this is a better question, but don't use them every day. Can you offer any reasons why?
Why?
Why you might not use them?
They are not intel. They just good for like giving you the information that you need, but they are not as detailed as a data.
Okay, so it's data. It might be relevant, but it's presented at a pretty high level, and it's not detailed enough to actually action on it. Adoption rate for not just dashboards, but business intelligence tools, as this industry is called in general, is under 30%. And you think about the fact that $14 billion are probably going to be spent this year on business intelligence tools worldwide, that's a pretty appalling number. We've narrowed it down to three reasons that make dashboards successful. First of all, the data has to be relevant, and relevance also pertains to granularity. It's not only relevant, but it's relevant at a level of detail that's actually useful to you. Integration. It's hard for a lot of people to remember to use another tool or to pick up or click on something. Here on this snapshot, we've integrated dashboards in so that you actually get notified on your mobile devices whenever a number hits a certain level or a problem happens, or just every Monday morning at 8 o'clock before your meeting. This level of integration has been very successful in our experience in getting adoption and helping people use the tools available to them. The last one is design, and that's what I'm about to talk about. So this is not one of ours. I've blocked out the name of the company at the top. It's not to be mean-spirited, but any thoughts about this dashboard? Yes?
Chromostereopsis.
I'm sorry?
Chromostereopsis. That means cold colors are going backwards, warm colors are going forwards on a gray background, and it's messing with your mind.
Wow, that's... okay, yeah. That's much better than I could have thought. Thank you. Yeah, it's definitely true. Did everybody hear that?
It messes with your mind.
Well, the colors are reversed, and they're all in a gray background, and it's messing with your mind. Anybody else? Might be a bit hard to see. Some of the things that I've noticed, some of the charts are remarkably small, very hard to read, legibility obviously incredibly important. The table has two decimal places and we're showing millions of dollars. It might be useful in some businesses, but quite often maybe you're just showing an unnecessary level of precision.
Actually, real quick,
yeah.
Is like one of the things that I first thought when I saw this is something from like 1993.
Yeah, it's an old one.
Does a dashboard need to be relevant to today's design expectation?
I think that today's design expectations are more evolved than they were back then. And so my answer would be yes.
But okay, so yeah, so you could have a great graphic, but if it's presented like something from 1993, people are not going to bother looking at it?
Well, I think this one's pixelated for one, and it looks pretty low res.
Yeah.
That could be part of it. If it were useful, I'd still use it. So there's some design details here that are clearly behind the times, or just less than optimal, that would definitely impede use. But things have changed. What's sad, though, is that this is what a lot of software out there still looks like today. Not just in terms of the resolution, that has improved a lot, or the typography, but just in terms of design paradigm. They force you into quadrants or six boxes when maybe you don't need six. There's a lot of inflexible software out there today. So it might not be the fault of the designer, it's just simply the tools they had access to. Any problems with this with regards to layout? Yes?
A lot of wasted space by not integrating some common elements, which I hope are the legends across graphs.
Yeah. Yeah, so within the different sections, sorry, it's not quite legible at this resolution. Or it's not legible, period. There's a lot of wasted space within the graphics themselves. Yes?
I agree that some of these graphics don't make good use of the space, but the concept of wasted space is one I have to fight against all the time for many years, mostly from math backgrounds or other backgrounds. And the use of some or a lot of blank space is actually better for perception.
Okay.
I would have to say that when I hear wasted space, it's like not that again.
I think, so you're saying that some white space is valuable for the purpose of perception. I certainly think that's a valid point. It's important not to have something that's too busy. But certainly if you look at the amount of space that's just used for navigation here, it takes up an incredible amount of space. In a lot of samples that you see online, you see massive titles or an enormous amount of space dedicated to the company logo. And as benign as that might sound, when these things add up really quickly, and what a lot of our clients end up having is a dashboard that's pushed pretty far down the screen. This is especially problematic with some of the newer laptops that are more have wider aspect ratios and they don't have as much height. And it forces you to scroll. And when you scroll, what happens is you tend to forget what you were looking at before. And this is why having everything visualized at a glance is important. This is one example of having a scroll. There's so much space dedicated at the top to navigation or nothing that the content is pushed further down. And now, as a result, we have to scroll to see the entire thing or zoom out. This is something that we see quite often in dashboards today, are the dials, gauges. Any thoughts with regards to those?
Looks nice.
Looks nice.
No, I said useless.
Oh, useless. Why?
Because they're not comparative. They're not readily comparable, and you're not driving a car. You're not checking steam in a nuclear turbine. They're just, they're from somewhere else, misapplied to here without ready appreciation of what you're trying to represent.
Yes. And beyond that, as well, is just the sheer amount of space they occupy. So beyond not being incredibly useful, and you can tell that something might have a problem when you actually have to show the number there as well to supplement the graphic. We do that a lot as well because we use a graphic to highlight something, and because a manager will ask for a precise number, we show the number as well. This is something taken to an extreme. But generally speaking, gauges don't work very well on dashboards. This is a simple moral of this story. They occupy an incredible amount of space to show one data point. So this entire portion of the screen is showing you an incredibly limited amount of information. About that car metaphor, I just put this out there. I think it's quite easy to say what's wrong here, but we call it a dashboard. It doesn't mean that it has to look like something that just came out of a car. And so I would use that metaphor lightly, wherever possible. So what are some dashboards that we design? What do they look like today? We have the challenge in our industry of making something look good and be useful at the same time. And in the data visualization blogosphere, there's two camps. There's the it must be beautiful camp, and then there's the it must look boring and just be useful camp. We have the challenge of trying to navigate somewhere in the middle. This is one example that I think succeeds in navigating that balance. We're showing various metrics for solar and wind installations here on a tablet device. And there's a combination of different graphics here. We've got spark lines to show you a trend across all these different devices, and actually if you click on them, you can drill into more detail if you want more precise values. We've got the bars in the green. These are known as bullet graphs as well, if you've ever heard of those, to show you a comparison between values. Immediately grab your attention so you know where you should look at first. That's one of the things about a dashboard like this that's used for monitoring purposes, where you want a problem to leap off the screen and yell at you. This is, if you use color sparingly, you can use emphasis colors like red and yellow to grab your attention. This is an example of what our mobile dashboards look like today. I'll show you a video at the end in case you're interested. Here's another sample. This is pretty information dense and admittedly doesn't have a lot of white space. This is a sample we built for the telecom industry. And we can explain this in a bit more detail if you're interested. But we've really reserved the use of color here to, or emphasis colors to the left side of the screen. So it's broken out into three big rows according to different business goals. And you can see the first one's highlighted in red. There's a problem there that we should probably look at.
This is on the
screen. Oh, sorry. So this is our mobile viewer.
The most important thing.
I created a video just to show you what
it's designed to work on all of your latest mobile devices, whether they're tablets or smartphones. The rectangles are called tiles, and each tile shows you a summary of a dashboard, a report, a subject area, or anything that's of interest to you. They are designed to rapidly give you an overview of your business. In this example, we use color to indicate that some areas warrant attention. We use tiles because they are so much more powerful than icons. Icons are just pictures that don't really tell you anything. This tile, however, shows you hundreds of data points and gives you a 12-month trend across all of your product categories, as well as a pacing indicator to show you how each one of them are pacing versus your targets and your goals. These tiles aren't just pictures. They are vector graphics that stay sharp when you zoom in, and they're connected to live data sources. You can connect as many data sources as you need, whether they're databases like SQL Server, Oracle, MySQL, or Access, cubes, data sourced from Google Analytics, Salesforce, social media APIs, or even just flat files in Excel spreadsheets. When the data updates, Dundas Mobile will update as well. The tiles will adjust according to your device's orientation. Each tile can point to a larger or more detailed piece of content. The content is rich, visual, and fully interactive. Furthermore, the content, visuals, tiles, everything you see here can be created by business users and sourced from content that's provided by and maintained by IT. We provide personalized training tailored to your needs, all designed to empower your teams to start creating their own content. We also have professional services teams that can do everything for you. A great home screen should only contain tiles that are relevant to you. But businesses, strategies, and situations change, and your home screen should be able to easily change as well. Changing your home screen is easy. Let's tap on Customize, remove all of the tiles on the screen, and start from scratch. You can tap on the Explore icon on the top right to navigate to our mobile Explorer. Here, you'll see all of the content that's available to you. You can search for content or navigate to different projects if you have more than one. Tap on an icon to navigate to a report. Let's say that sell-through is a report that is of particular interest. Tap on the pin button at the top, and a sell-through summary will appear on your home screen. We've designed this one to turn red and alert us if we have some important products that are about to sell out. If you go back to the Explorer, you can tap on Customize and quickly add tiles to your home screen. Sometimes you'll have the option to choose from more than one tile. Perhaps there are different ways to summarize this content. Now that all the tiles are back on the home screen, simply click on Customize and move the tiles around to sort them to your liking. And just like that, you have a home screen that gives you a real-time snapshot of your business. You can customize and choose how you want things to appear. Stay connected to your data, whenever you need it, wherever you go. Call us or send us an email to learn more. Thanks for watching.
Sorry about that sales pitch. But I just wanted to give you an idea of what some of our software looks like today. And what we've done there is taken the concept of a home screen or a landing page, and we've tried to take individual data components and actually turn that into a bit of a dashboard in itself. So those are all the concepts that I have to present to you today. Our session ends at 8, and I wanted to dedicate the next 20 minutes to a group exercise, if you're up for it. And the prize, we have something to give away to everybody, but the prize is one of the books from Stephen Few. It's called Show Me the Numbers. It's a very practical book that shows you how you can, just by using tables and graphs, improve how you communicate in your daily lives and at work. And it's been an incredibly useful book for me, and I hope it will be for the winners as well. So, here's the challenge. Sorry, just bear with me for a moment. Just disappeared off my screen.
So this might be a bit hard to read for folks in the back. But what we have here is a massive table. This is not an easy challenge, by the way. I've struggled for a long time to come up with a solution here. The expectation in 20 minutes is not for you to get guys to design a full-blown dashboard, but it is to kind of, on a big piece of flip chart, describe how you would go about putting one of these dashboards together. So the expectation is not to actually plot out all the different line charts or bar charts or spark lines or bullet graphs, but it's to lay out in sections how you would go about putting one of these together. So let me just explain a bit about the data. We've all been students before, and this is a data, a table that contains information that's pertinent to a teacher. And it shows all the information, or a bunch of information that's relevant to her algebra classes as a high school teacher. And so we've got all the students listed down there. We've got how many times they've been absent, late, how many times they've been sent to the office, detentions, marks from the last 5 assignments, marks in math from grades 6 through to 10, and also their grades, previous grade for the last math course, their current goal that they're aspiring to, and where they're at right now. And your challenge for that prize, and we're going to break you up into groups, 9 groups. Oh, sorry. Yeah, well, I think we'll break you up into maybe 8 or 9 groups, is to come up with a solution for this. We'll give it 20 minutes. Use your time wisely. And after, please select one person to actually come up here and present to us.
So the dashboard is for the teacher.
The dashboard is for a teacher. It's something to help the teacher, say, every day manage her classroom better, for example. So really conceptual. Keep it really high level. Don't get stuck in the weeds. You only got 20 minutes. Question?
Can you quickly repeat the data?
Sure.
What it is and where?
There are some acronyms here. On the left, we've got whether or not they speak English. So there's an N for 2 students. Special ed students, there are 2 of them. Their names, how many times they've been absent or late, how many times they've been sent to the office, detentions, and how many late assignments they have. So this section right here is behavioral. And this section right here on the right side, the other half of the screen, is related to performance. What are their marks for the last 5 assignments? What have their grades been for the last 5 years? What their previous letter grade was in math, their current goal, and where they're at right now. For example, Holly, very first row, her previous grade was an A. She's aspiring to an A, and her current grade is an A. It's a very limited amount of time. So, really, it's about conceptually how you would put something together. I think maybe we'll turn each one of the tables into different groups. I know there's people at the back who don't have a table. If you could just join one really quickly, and we'll go about handing out the flip charts. You can come see me if you have any questions. We'll regroup at 7:50.
and take a look at some of the answers. So who'd like to go first? Okay, you're up. Sir, how do I pronounce your name?
Petri.
Okay, everyone, please put your hands together for Team Petri, I'm assuming. Okay. Yay.
So, we have some bits to hold in that.
Oh, okay, I'll hold it up.
I'll have those.
Okay.
There you go. That's what I went to school for.
Okay.
So you need a mic.
In this room, do I think
it's exactly fine? Yeah. It's great to be powerful.
We're good.
All right, so what we looked at here is just a sample of two people and just applied some of the principles to the charts here. First off, looking at the behavior area, the thing I noticed is that most of the behavior areas are empty. So what we had wanted to do was just blank out, just with a solid color, all of the items that did not have any information, just so you could pay quicker attention to that. And then just use color coding for any exceptions. Like if, you know, we just made up some data to show an extreme data point. So if there was an extreme data point, it would just show up in a brighter color, just using like red, amber, green type principles. On the far, the English special ed sort of thing, just using sort of like a dot marker on the end. And then the assignments are, you can't compare assignment one and assignment two. They're vertically comparable across students, however, so a bar chart there. Then just so it's just a little more clarity there to show it, you know, where the end ends. And then the grade seems very similar to the spark chart comparison, or the spark line comparison. So we just show a spark line for the previous grades to show the previous grade, because these are, it makes less sense to compare these down than across their own previous years. And then we, you know, fudge the data here a bit to show that, you know, here's expectations met, you know, this might have been green to show it made, but here, you know, previous A, expected A, and the current is a B, so they're not meeting their expectations, and therefore they get a nice red B. So it just blanks that info a bit that they're, you know, not meeting them. That's it.
Very cool. We get a little bit of applause. For this one. The blank down areas, you colored them in to show that they're blank. Do you actually intend on filling them with anything?
This year?
Yeah.
The idea was that there's no data there, so don't, you know, pay attention there, so you're not trying to compare the empty spots.
Okay.
So you can just immediately pick up the data.
Okay. All right, thanks a lot, guys. Good job. All right, there's Team Patrick. That table. Hey.
Actually, that's okay. Yeah. Can you guys see it if it's not lit?
It's easier to see it if it's not lit.
Yeah? All right, so when we first tackled this this project, the very first question we asked ourselves is, what are the core elements? And Nelson was kind enough to give them to us when we first started by saying there's two elements, behavior and performance. So we decided to split into two, and we looked at the core elements of behavior, and we saw absenteeism, lateness, detention, and office. And this box here, these boxes, would I give you a sort of a numerical number of total absences based on the semester or the year or whatever is the current curriculum. And I'm actually going to ask Ashram, because he's considerably smarter than I am, on how he chose that the best way the data would be represented.
So for example, we can use histograms here to show the number of times that students have been absent. Like with this histogram, I can show that like 10 times, like we have 10 students that had two absences, and then for example, we had four students that were absent five times. So general information like that. And then when they click on that, this histogram, they can see more detailed information based on the name of the student.
So the next item we tackled was performance, and there's a lot of data on performance. We didn't really want to focus on individual students, but give teachers a quick sort of overview. We also made an assumption that if this data and this dashboard is available for one teacher, it's probably available for other teachers. So
we made an assumption for filters, and they're not completely listed there, but you could add filters to a graph that shows assignments and grades per class compared to the school average, compared to other teachers, compared to other schools in the, you know, the community and so on. And on the right here is a list of your own students that once again you could sort of click on, and it would sort of superimpose sort of the trends for both graphs, and you could compare how your students are doing compared to your class, compared to the school, compared to their peers, compared to the whole region if you really wanted to. And there would also be other elements that would show sort of current grade status, sort of like a little red, green, yellow, you know, that indicates they're doing okay, they could be doing better, they could be doing a lot better. And that's, and obviously, like anything else, you click on them, it would show more details, but for the dashboard, that's what we got.
Good job. Next team.
If I can get some help.
Oh, do you guys get this? Or, you guys can hang on to it.
I'll put it on my wallet.
And this is team?
I know, team awesome, I guess.
Team awesome, okay. All right. For team awesome?
So,
I'm just going to limit it to 2 minutes, if that's okay.
Okay. The way we divide out our dashboard is by trying to break down the tasks that the teacher might have. And so we figured that two things that she might want to do is to compare, is to look at overall class performance. And over on the right-hand side there, we have a snapshot, which would kind of be like a scatter plot, like a matrix, showing where how students perform compared to their peers and compared to their goals on the right side. And that right graphic there would interact with the main display here on the right side, which would be used to get a comparative view for the teacher of each of the students. And so here she could see for each sort of row in this chart how students are doing. And generally we decide to code the data on an axis or on a scale of red being poor and green being overperforming or doing better than average. On the left-hand side, we have sort of like, we couldn't figure out the term, but we were thinking of calling it like a confounds or a predisposition for the students. So whether they were a language student or in special education, their name, their behavioral indicators, as you were describing here. So whether it was green or red, so that would be indicative of whether they're below average or above average compared to their peers. And then spark lines for the assignments over the past five assignments and grades over the past five sets of grades over the 5 years, that is. And overall, you could see whether or not the student was in the background of each of these, you'd have a green or a red compared to their peers. And so you would see per row whether it was more green or more red. And so you could select each of these rows, and then you could see where that student would lie on the right side there. And vice versa, if you selected a data point on the right, you could see where they are. And of course, you could sort by performance for each of these columns, just to do more exploratory analysis, if you will. So we embedded a little bit of interactivity with this.
Does anybody know what that form of interactivity is called when you click on something on the left and it shows up and it's highlighted on the right? Before Jeff answers. Jeff?
Brushing?
Yeah, it's called brushing. So, the word comes from if you were to brush down with your mouse and click on subsequent student names, you're saying that you would see some sort of interactivity on the right side of the screen. So that's what that's called, in case you're interested. Thank you, team awesome. Great job. Who's up next? Sam from team?
Data VizWiz.
That's great.
Do you want to make notes?
Thank you. All right, so we were trying to emphasize how little time teachers have to prepare for lessons, so I really want to hit at the core of what teachers want to know before they get to class. And for us, once we get a list of the students, the biggest things we want to look at are the problem kids, right? So we get the warning symbol here for problem kids. We also get the keeners with the sunshine there. And we also represent learning challenge, I guess learning disabilities and language challenges with certain students. We also do a little spark graph of their trend to goal, so their grades versus the goal line, which is represented with the dotted line. So you get a really quick representation here, and then you just click on a student's name, and it just blows up into this graph, which shows you grades on different assignments and quizzes, and problem areas indicated visually. And then you just get as simple as the current average and their current goal. So really, really quick, in just 30 seconds, you can see where your problems lie before you enter the classroom, and maybe how to remedy them. That's it.
Awesome.
Thank you, team Data VizWiz. All right, who's up next? Team in the corner. Is it?
Team Super Awesome.
Team Super Awesome.
Wow, we're trumping each other with names now. Hey, Jeff, do you mind actually coming up here and helping out with the mic?
Something to work?
Whatever they need.
Thank you so much. Okay, so this is the best dashboard that we'll ever have. So actually, what you have to do is to bring the class on the screen, because the teacher deals with the children, right? So you need to bring the whole class on the screen. So we decided to plot the position of every individual kid on the screen. And since we know that bad behavior spreads like wildfire, so it's very important that you can highlight the bad behavior on the single individual. So you can click on different tabs here with the different behavioral variables here, and then we'll highlight a heat map showing what's the behavior of the actual kid. So actually the teacher has some action here that can take. So you can move kids around and hopefully let the good behavior spread. That's okay, and what's very important here is the interactivity. So basically we have the list of all the students, and the sparkline represents the performance over the 5 years. And so when you click on one individual here, it's highlighted within the class. And again, you can choose, you can decide to move them around the class. And the very last part was rather quick, but and actually this represents another performance, which is the I don't know, something like this, the grades across the years, and then their goal and expected performances. That's it.
Very cool. Thank you, team. Super awesome. Anybody? Who's up next?
We'll be up next.
Okay, and your team name?
The Most Awesome.
Please give it up for our team, The Most Awesome.
The Most Originally Awesome.
I got it.
I can start, you guys can come on. Well, we began by asking what the most important question for this teacher was, and we determined that it would be to help the students who are in need of help. So in a sort of home screen or large tile, which you can then brush from, we would organize just the key information, which would be students and their grades, including their previous grade, their goal, and this would be color-coded, like many other people have suggested, perhaps red and green, denoted, like people struggling could be denoted by color, red. And each of these columns could be selectable and sortable. So the teacher, in this case, has determined that she wants to see who's performing the poorest at the top. And then going from that, you would click on a student to find out more information.
So we thought that one of the most important things here, this is cutting out, would be to compare the behavior with grades. So the grades for the assignments are used with the, the sparkline. And then we decided to plot absences, lates, detentions, and that kind of thing in clusters with dots along the line there. So basically, the line at the bottom is like a timeline. And as the year progresses, the spark line fills up, and so do the kind of clusters of bad behavior. So you can see if the bad behavior is affecting marks or not.
And we thought time was something that was missing from this table that we decided to add, because then things like absence is, this we think gives you a better picture visually of what is happening in the year.
So then we also decided not to mark the ESL students or special education students on the first screen, but rather to include it on the second screen here as perhaps a contributing cause of poor marks, potentially. And then we also have you can choose to use the current or the past 5 years view here.
Thank you, team. The most awesome. Who's left?
Yeah, come on up.
Okay, and your team name?
David.
Team David. Team David. So you guys awesome. Can talk. Please give it up for Team David.
Oh. I'm kind of the same. we've broken this down into a few main panes, and so we have this performance one at the top and a behavior one at the bottom. So the performance on the left, we have this year, we have the list of students, but I only have the top one. And then this spark line here indicates the performance across the 5 assignments, just to kind of get the trend. And then the final one will be this bar to show the most recent assignment, so it can easily be compared with the, you know, the rest of the students, even though we only have one indicated, and then just small symbols to show either the ESL or the special needs, and then on the right we have, you know, a breakdown showing it being able to compare the assignments. We didn't go into too much detail here. And in the bottom pane, we're showing just a summary of, you know, behavioral things. So by a person's name, you know, we can say the office referrals and the detention, and then just combining the two numbers, you know, are they going up or are they going down? Just, you know, kind of show the trend. And we have the absences and the lates. And then just a little bit of color coding here, just blue to show one way or another, you know, there's a problem. So we have 10 absences or whatever. And then we have a couple smaller panes on the right. Just this top one is to kind of show your kind of most recent anomaly or outlier or alert, I guess we call it, because we have all these sorts of things that'll just analyze the number and it'll come up, I guess, green or blue in this case, show you if it's good or bad. And then we summarize in the bottom left, you know, here are all your students who aren't meeting their goals. So kind of this column in the far right. And so you can, you know, go into all those, see, you know, who needs help. And then if you want more information about a particular student, we put a search bar in the top right corner, and it would be in there that you would probably get the spark for the past 5 years. You're probably not wanting to be comparing, you know, this kind of history across students, but it'll come up, you know, when you're looking at a particular student.
Up next, do we have any? Is that it? Is anybody not gone?
Anybody not willing?
Or anybody not willing to go? It's optional.
You don't want to go again?
Okay, thank you, everybody. That was actually really interesting. One of the more fun. One of the most fun things about working as a consultant at Dundas is we get to meet a lot of different individuals at many different companies and learn how they do business. Whether it's whether they're in healthcare, consumer packaged goods, the financial industry. What's quite apparent to me about this room is there's a lot of people here who are probably a lot smarter than I am, and so we saw a lot of really good ideas. That said, I do want to show you my solution to the problem. And 1 second, sorry. And this is what mine looks like. And while you guys were talking, I was actually thinking about ways I could improve mine, because there's certainly some really good ideas out there. And if I just go through some of the teams, Team Petri, what was remarkable about yours is that we saw student-level information. It's really granular. The use of data bars to show differences in magnitude between the different assignments. Team That Table, props for putting in a histogram and different types of visualizations in there. Team Awesome, a demonstration of brushing and interactivity. Data VizWiz, pictographs, using more different visual representations to give people an idea of the various dispositions of their students. Team Super Awesome with the heat map and brushing as well, I think I saw there. Team The Most Awesome. What was cool about this team was the linking between behavior and grades. I thought that was pretty cool. What I've done here is I've created a section called behavior, and it's not behavioral issues for every student, but it's not to say that it's okay if you're always absent, but you still have high marks, but I've limited to students who have the most behavioral issues and also are in, I think, the bottom quartile of grades. So I thought that was very interesting. Team David, definitely with the search capability, struck me, because that's actually becoming more of a recurring theme in business intelligence today, and is showing up on more and more dashboards. And there were a lot of good things about yours. Another thing that popped up was the use of tiles. You didn't call it that, but immediately I was thinking, well, one of the big challenges when you're designing for tablets or phones is the form factors are all different. How do you design for something that fits all these different dimensions? And when you looked at the mobile video earlier, that was one way that we thought of going about that problem. It's if the tiles can move and adjust to your device and be responsive, that's one way to solve that problem. So really good job, everybody. I have the there were seven teams. I have the unfortunate responsibility of making enemies out of the other six. But because of just the level of granularity and the brushing, I'm picking Team Awesome as the winner. So, I realize I've gone way overboard on time. Thank you so much, everybody, for your patience. A couple of things just to, just because a few questions did pop up earlier.
Nelson.
Yes?
Do you want to tell Team Awesome about the prizes?
Oh! Yeah. So, Team Awesome, we'll hand it out to you in a bit, but this is your prize. It's the Show Me the Numbers book I mentioned earlier from Stephen Few. If you get a chance to pick up this book, I really do recommend it. Actually, it's kind of nerdish, but I give it away as gifts as well. It's a really good gift item. So I should have said that. People have asked, well, how do we keep in touch if we have other questions? Certainly, we're going to stick around. Pizza's just arrived. There's drinks there, and you guys obviously are all welcome. I wanted to show you, and it's disappeared. Oh, here it is. Our Facebook page, which is not very well followed at the moment. We're just beginning kind of our social media campaign. But if you guys have anything interesting or just want to stay in touch, this is a really easy way of doing that, getting our business cards. We also have a LinkedIn group called Dundas Data Visualization Incorporated. And you guys are always welcome to join that board if we see anything interesting sometimes new blog posts or things that we're seeing. Kind of in the news or interesting things that we've done, you'll find out about them here. So I'm going to stop droning on and on. I really hope you guys got something out of this today. I hope that at the very least, we won't be seeing some of the data visualization sins we've seen earlier. Based on what I've seen in this room today, I'm pretty sure nothing that comes out of you guys will ever end up in our hall of shame. And actually, I think there's a lot of potential that I'm seeing here. So thank you, everybody, for your time today, and hope to talk to you in just a bit. Oh, sorry. Before you go, I forgot. Just bring up David from the Association for Information.
Also, there's some pens and USBs if you guys want to pick them up on your way out. Knock yourself out.
Just not literally. Thank you, everyone, for coming here today and staying at last. We have...
So thank you for coming here today and staying with us. We have pizza here, so please feel free to help yourself with food and socialize. There's a lot of people who are interested in this area, students, professionals from companies, and please get to know each other. And if you are willing to know more about our future events, similar to this one, we will have more. This piece of paper is handed out to you when you came, and there's more on the table outside, so when you're leaving, if you want to sign up for, we have a Twitter account, Facebook, and LinkedIn, and our email is there. And if you're interested in partnering with us for future workshops, please let me know, or Kim know, our vice president, and enjoy the food. Thank you.